My name is Troy Magney. I'm a PhD candidate in the Geospatial Laboratory for Environmental Dynamics at the University of Idaho. And I work with Lee Vierling and Jan Eidel. And I work across both the REACCH project and the site-specific climate-friendly farming project. And today I'm going to be talking a bit about estimating nitrogen uptake from space and the potential for integration and how we can use this in management scenarios. So, as many of you know, here in the Palouse, we have very heterogeneous topography, and our nitrogen use efficiencies range anywhere from 10 to 80% at the field scale, maybe even 0 to 100%. And with that, there's a lot of opportunity for precision ag and for figuring out where we can apply fertilizers to optimize their efficiency, so that all of that fertilizer that we apply is taken up in an ideal world. So, in this example here, I have a picture of the Colfax farm, one of the research farms we work at, and you take a look at this red, green, blue digital camera image, and you can see that it all looks very green. But I want to talk about the hidden information behind that greenness, and in particular, figure out where, say, we can apply, say, 120 kilograms per hectare of fertilizer in this draw here, and maybe in the hill slopes here, maybe 80 kilograms per hectare, and moving up from that, maybe 60. This, of course, is just one example of what we can do. And as many of you know, improving nitrogen use efficiency can reduce losses of excess nitrogen to the environment and save farmers money by optimizing their inputs. So a lot of what I do is figure out how we can measure things. The thing I like to think about is how can we manage what we can't measure. So when I'm walking around the field and I'm looking at a green field that looks very heterogeneous, I'm thinking about all the layers of information we can build on top of that. So one of the ways we can measure this is on the ground. And this makes for a great validation tool. This is a spectral reflectance sensor made by Decagon Devices, and we use this to measure very fine wavelengths of the electromagnetic spectrum. And this gives us an idea exactly how plants are reflecting light. And with this information, we can begin to understand how light is reflected all the way to the satellite. Additionally, we've designed an instrument in our lab called an autonomously operating terrestrial laser scanner, which is a mouthful. And this we mount on towers in the field, and it shoots out a laser pulse, and it scans in 360 degrees, both in the azimuth and zenith angles, and gets a really good idea of a 3D map of the field. And from there, we can figure out and basically create a daily map of how the crop is growing. Additionally, with active laser-based systems, we worked with a system called the GECCO, which is the Green Economic Chlorophyll Observer, which we mounted on a four-wheeler and drove around the field to try to get an idea of how much nitrogen there is in the crop at early growth stages. And lastly, what I'm going to talk about today is how a lot of this ground-based work has been scaled up to space and how we can map patterns of nitrogen uptake from satellite systems. So as you all know, patterns of crop nitrogen uptake vary across time and space. Here you see a daily resolution from a time-lapse camera, again at the research farm out in Colfax. You can see how much these patterns change on a daily basis. And this is just 9 days. But what we really want to do is see beyond that and see, okay, how much nitrogen is actually being taken up by the crop. And this image here is a 3D map of what we've measured as satellite-derived nitrogen uptake. Lastly, we want to figure out what is driving these patterns. And we can do this by combining different models that other scientists are working on to figure out what is driving these patterns of nitrogen uptake across space and time. So a lot of this research began with the site-specific climate-friendly farming team, and this is our leadership team here. You can see we work with a wide range of disciplines. Most of these scientists all work with the REACCH project, so it's been great to utilize resources from REACCH and the work that we do with the SCF project. In addition, there has been a multitude of graduate students that have come in and out over the years. Here we are out at one of our sites in Leland after the harvest. So I'll talk a little bit about the research sites that we've had established for the last 3 years. So they range across a precipitation gradient from east to west, and they start out in Colfax, and they go all the way to Leland. And these four farms, we work with farmers to figure out what's going on in their field and how they can use the information we're learning to figure out how they can better apply their inputs. At each one of these sites, we have full-time long-term monitoring networks where we're measuring electrical conductivity, soil temperature, soil moisture, among other things. So here's a map of how that precipitation gradient does vary. And you can see from all the way from the Colfax farm to the Leland farm, which are the two farms I'm going to be focusing on today, we have almost a 2 to 3-fold increase in the mean annual precipitation. So they give us very different systems, of course, both rain-fed systems to think about. So like I said, a lot of the methods we work with, the automated measurements, of course, are at these 12 designated sites at each one of the Tier 2 research farms. We also have a weather station at each farm. So we have Flume collecting information about nitrate runoff, among other things. And then, of course, I threw in the satellite because that's flying over every 5 to 10 days and collecting measurements at these farms. Additionally, we collect manual measurements of these farms, and I've only noted the ones that our group collects, the plant people, which are leaf area index, leaf nitrogen concentration, leaf chlorophyll content, soil or inorganic nitrogen, soil carbon, bulk density, and many more that are collected from our interdisciplinary research group. So a little bit about the remote sensing theory, how this all works. So we have passive sensors and active sensors. A passive sensor is what I first showed you, the spectral reflectance radiometer, which is using the sun's reflected energy to capture photons to then give us information about how plants are reflecting light. Whereas this active sensor here is shooting out a source. It's shooting out a laser. This is an active source, and we get information based on the time it takes for that laser to leave the source, hit the object, and come back to the sensor. A satellite, of course, is a passive sensor because a satellite relies on energy being reflected from the sun and coming back to the satellite. Now, a satellite also can't see through clouds, which is a big limitation. These instruments work under clouds, so we can get daily high-resolution measurements to validate what we see from space. I want to talk a little bit about why this works and why we can use information of light reflected by plants from the sun to understand plant responses, plant function, and plant structure. So if you look here on the y-axis, we have plant reflectance. So this is how much light energy is being reflected by the plant, and on the x-axis we have wavelength. Think back to your ninth grade physics course and think about how we can see it from 0.4 to 0.8 micrometers, 0.4 to 0.7, and then everything beyond that we can't see. But we can see it with these satellite sensors. So, for example, if you think about how plant pigments and plant nutrient concentration are reflected in the electromagnetic spectrum, look at this orange circle here. That's largely a result of what happens in that visible spectrum, in the part of the spectrum that plants are actually using energy for photosynthesis. If you want to get information about water content, you can go out further in the spectrum. You can go out into what's called the shortwave infrared, where these blue circles are. And if you want to get information about leaf area, you can look in this yellow circle here. And leaf area is largely responsive in the near-infrared part of the spectrum. So by combining these different the reflectance in these different wavelengths, we can get an idea of plant pigments, plant water content, more or less, and leaf area. So the satellite we use is called RapidEye. Keep in mind, this is not a freely available satellite. I'll talk more about those at the end of the presentation. But one of the really nice things about the RapidEye satellite is it measures a part of the spectrum that has been found to be really tightly correlated with chlorophyll and in turn nitrogen concentration, which is the red edge part of the spectrum. So if you look at these different bands on this figure here, you can see that RapidEye measures in the blue, green, red, red edge, and near infrared parts of the spectrum. And we use different combinations of these bands to figure out, to basically try to figure out what we want to learn about what's going on the ground. And one that we found to be really effective for measuring plant nitrogen uptake is the normalized different red edge index, which is a combination of that near infrared and the red edge parts of the spectrum, which I have circled here. Another thing about RapidEye is that it's pixels. So if you think about when you zoom into a camera image really, really close, you begin to see little squares. Those are all little pixels. And those are at a much finer resolution than we can get from space. Well, RapidEye reproduces 5 by 5 meter pixels on the ground, whereas some of the freely available satellite produces 30 by 30 meters on the ground. So we're trying to figure out what scale is really right for farmers and how much information do they need. In addition, the RapidEye satellite will fly over our sites every 5 to 10 days and we'll get an image depending on cloud conditions. Also, there's been extensive ground validation for this satellite in our lab by one of my advisors, Jan Eidel. So one of the ways we try to figure out how much nitrogen is in fact being taken up by the crop from space is we set up experiments like this kind of quilt work you see here at the Cook Farm, where we have three replicates, field A, B, and C, of 16 different small plots that have 4 different fertilizer applications. And bear in mind, each one of these little patches on this quilt is 10 by 10 meters, so we're ensuring that a satellite pixel can fit inside that patch. In addition, we set up variable rate strips, like you see here at the Colfax farm in 2013, where we have 3 different rates that kind of range throughout the whole farm to get an idea of spatially how this field is responding to fertilizer application. Creating maps of above ground N, when you just look at this picture of the Leland farm, the spring wheat in 2013, it's just green. It's really hard to know which parts of the field are taking up more nitrogen than other parts. And for example, in this time-lapse image, which captured me staring directly into the camera, I don't look very, very pleased. It's tough. And so as a result, we take a lot of ground-based measurements and we harvest the above-ground crop and then process it for percent nitrogen and biomass. And then we scale that up to the satellite signal and use it as a ground validation. In these results here, you can see how on the y-axis, the actual above-ground nitrogen that we've harvested compares with what we measured from space, the normalized difference red edge index on the x-axis. This particular plot here is an R-squared of 0.72 and a root mean square error of 20 kilograms per hectare of nitrogen, which we feel pretty comfortable with. And you can also see how these vary based on the color along that line of the farm from which these samples were taken. For example, the Troy site, which was one of our wetter sites, are all the blue dots, which show the highest above-ground nitrogen uptake and the highest NDRE values. Now we're at the point where we have our satellite image. We want to create a map of above-ground nitrogen. So if you just look at the red, green, blue satellite image, the same bands that are used to create a digital picture, you can see that the field looks relatively green. If you look closely, you can see the red dots, which are our long-term monitoring sites. But if you begin to use an NDRE image and combine it with the slope and the intercept of that validation regression line I just showed you, you can create a map of above-ground nitrogen. And here, ranging from low nitrogen in the white to high nitrogen in the green, you can see how this spatially varies across the field. And it's pretty remarkable to see the patterns that come out of this. From this, we want to see, okay, which parts of the field are actually taking up this nitrogen that's applied. So we overlay it with a map of applied nitrogen. So we take the satellite computed above ground nitrogen, divide that by the nitrogen that's applied, and we get this map here ranging from 0 to 2, where 1, all the tan colors, are taking up about as much nitrogen as was applied. All the green areas are taking up more nitrogen than what was applied, and the red areas are taking up less nitrogen than what was applied. And what really struck us when we looked at this was this kind of L in the middle of the field. And we got to talking with the hydrologists and the soil scientists, and we were like, this doesn't make a lot of sense based on what we know about the field, how water varies throughout the field. What could this be? And some hypotheses that we threw out there were, well, maybe this area has improved internal drainage, warmer soil temperatures, which results in earlier nutrient mineralization, spurs growth rate and development, establishes deeper root system, and creates greater water and nitrogen use efficiency. And then we went to actually talk to the farmer and showed him maps of, for example, electroconductivity, which still don't really line up with this L. And he's like, oh, well, that's just a fence line that we haven't farmed for 10 years. So it does support a lot of the potential explanations we had for that area. It's just that it hadn't been conventionally farmed on about a 10 meter radius on either side of that line for up to 10 years. So it really goes to show you how much healthier that soil was, in fact, than the rest of the field. So then we wanted to see how this crazy L that we saw varies over time. So we looked back at the garbanzo beans in 2012, and you can kind of see that L popping out, but it's not too convincing. Then you go back to this 2013 image, and you see that L, and which I had shown previously. And then you go up to 2014 with the winter wheat, and that L is kind of there, but not entirely. And this could also be due to the fact that we actually asked this farmer if we could do some control strips on his plot. So that might have varied what we're looking at here, but it's still kind of there. So the next question is, can we use these patterns over time to manage our fields? You know, it's easy to look at that map and say, okay, here's where nitrogen is being taken up, here's where it's not. But the real question is, why is this? So if we go back to our Colfax farm here, I want to talk briefly about how we can combine a soil moisture routing model developed by our hydrologists with some of this satellite-derived nitrogen information. So first of all, if you take a look at that 3D map of the normalized difference red edge index from June 15th, 2013, you can see how these patterns vary, similar to that picture I just showed you. And now, if you kind of invert your brain a little bit and look top down at this map, you can see a map of soil moisture on that same date that was created using the soil moisture routing model. And it's work done by Matt Urich in the Bio and Ag Engineering Department. So we're thinking about ways to combine this data. So if we take a map of the soil volumetric water content, and we overlay it with the normalized difference red edge index, plot each pixel on top of each other. Bear in mind they're both 5 meter by 5 meter pixel maps that were resampled on top of each other. We can get an idea that the fit of that line, which I show here in the top right of this image, is going to be our field average. So that'll be the average N uptake per unit water. Everywhere in orange, so all the residuals above that line, are going to be where there's more nitrogen uptake per unit water, and all the areas in blue, the residuals below that line, are areas where there is less nitrogen uptake per unit water. Of course, this leads to many more questions. Now we've combined hydrology information with nitrogen uptake information, but if we really want to work towards an integrated understanding of field scale patterns over space and time, we need to begin to use maps created by other folks we work with on the project, including digital soil maps, digital terrain modeling maps, again, soil moisture routing maps, and crop system modeling. So in the future, we can potentially take these maps of these residuals, like I had shown, where the orange areas are high nitrogen uptake per unit water, the blue areas are limited nitrogen uptake per unit water, and we can maybe look at this area circled in A, for example, and say, okay, this area is not being that productive based on how much water is available. Let's back off on the fertilizer a little bit and maybe try to save some money, understanding that we can't really improve the yield as much as we think in that area. So now I just want to talk briefly to conclude here about remote sensing in agriculture and a lot of the potential limitations of this work. So according to a recent REACCH poll of Pacific Northwest growers, 43% of respondents reported that they don't use available precision agriculture technologies because the equipment is too expensive. 30% said the software is too expensive and requires too much technical support or training. And 27% reported that it is too time-consuming to learn. And I agree. It's expensive stuff, it's hard to understand, and it is indeed time-consuming. So what can we do moving forward? Well, we can make sure that these technologies are giving us the information we think they are, and that's largely a lot of the validation work I had shown earlier. We can begin to think about how we can do simple tech transfer to growers to help them understand these spatial patterns across their fields. Then we can evaluate how well these tools are working using field scale evaluation, actually applying different rates of fertilizer like we've been doing at these fields and seeing how well they're responding to our recommended amounts. Additionally, we can provide growers with field scale data and allow their innovation to aid in their own management. I think this is really important that we don't tell growers how they should manage their fields. We can just give them the information because, in fact, they are way more clever and way smarter than us about their fields, and they know what they need to do to manage their fields more efficiently. So remote sensing is far off from being a one-off solution. I think it's been largely oversold by a lot of different communities as something to say, hey, here's a drone. This is all you need to manage your field. These are complex fields. There's a lot going on. There's a lot we need to be aware of. There's a lot to understand about field scale patterns as compared to this field in Nebraska on the right, which is just flat. Not to say there's not variability there, it's just a very different system. So yeah, we need to be more upfront about our limitations. Our fields are complex and we're working to try to understand them, and there's a lot going on and a lot that can be learned. And that's what makes it a particularly exciting system for me, and I know a lot of our collaborators, to work in. This needs to be bottom up and not top down. We need to be working with growers like we're doing at these tier two research sites and figure out what their needs are. And of course, there are so many other things I haven't mentioned. In conclusion, satellite imagery can be used to estimate spatially and temporally explicit nitrogen uptake. An interdisciplinary approach could lead to a more process-based understanding of the drivers of this nitrogen uptake. We need to be aware of our limitations, because what about all the things we can't model? We can't model that fence line. We have no idea that's there. That just popped out of us, and I think it's fascinating. So there's a lot of work to be done, and thanks for listening.